y'all. This hearing examines changes to Social Security's disability appeals process. And you know, today is the 19th hearing that we've held on Social Security Disability Insurance Program. And as the chairman of Social Security Subcommittee, over the years, we have talked about the challenges facing the disability program and the need to make some real changes to improve how it works for claimants, beneficiaries, and taxpayers. And we've spent a lot of time talking about the program because it's so important. Yet, since 2003, the disability program has been on GAO's high-risk list primarily because it desperately needs to be modernized. America wants, needs, and deserves a disability appeals process that's fair, accurate, and timely. And the decision should be the same no matter whether the claimant is filed in Texas, Connecticut, or Michigan. Unfortunately, that's not always the case today. Recently, Social Security announced its decision to reinstate reconsideration. For those not familiar, reconsideration is a full second review of a rejected claim by a different examiner. On average, the processing time for this step is about 100 days. This move would make sure that the appeals process is the same throughout the country, but there are real questions about the value of reinstating reconsideration. While some people might get a decision sooner under reconsideration, for others, this step is effectively a rubber stamp of the initial decision, and it simply further delays their hearing with an administrative law judge. Reinstating reconsideration is a big decision to make, especially given that the Social Security has been without a commissioner for more than 5 years. Isn't that terrible? We need to understand why Social Security thinks now is the time to make this change. I'm pleased that President Trump has put forward a nominee for commissioner. However, he hasn't even had a hearing yet. I want to take this opportunity to call on my Senate colleagues to confirm the next Social Security Commissioner, I hope before Labor Day. And if y'all will push that issue with me, I think we can get one. Social Security needs leadership, and they need it now. And we need the leadership of a commissioner to ensure Social Security has a consistent nationwide appeals process. And any change made need to be backed up by data showing how any changes benefit both the claimant and the taxpayer. Americans deserve nothing less. I thank our witnesses for being here today, and I look forward to hearing your testimony. And hopefully we'll get some more people up here. We'll note that too, won't we?
Yes, sir.
I now recognize Mr. Larson for his opening.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman, and may I say what a great feeling it is to be back in this room, but especially to be back in this new and renovated and newly named room after our distinguished chairman, Mr. Johnson, and whose portrait will gaze down on all of us and will continue to be timeless. What an honor, and as a point of personal privilege, it is to be associated with and to serve with Sam Johnson, having most recently had the opportunity to be at both the portrait unveiling and the ribbon cutting of this room. I think an important, all too often in America, and especially in our public school systems, we don't know enough about history, nor the great sacrifice that people have made on behalf of their country. Sam Johnson is a living legend, exemplifies everything about service above self and love of country. And it's always an honor to be in his presence and serve him. While we may disagree from time to time over things, mostly, as people might find this shocking, we agree more than we would disagree. And I especially applaud him for his hearing and his dedication, especially when it comes to disability, to making sure that these the programs of Social Security, the administration of Social Security, is intact. So it's great to be here, Mr. Chairman. And I'd also like to thank our witnesses for joining us here today, and especially to Lisa Ekman from the Consortium of Citizens with Disabilities. Millions of Americans rely on Social Security for basic income when they are retired. If they become severely disabled and can no longer work, or for survivor's benefits, there is no private plan on the market that can compare to Social Security. Since 2010, the number of beneficiaries has grown by 15% as the baby boomers reach retirement age. But Social Security's operating budget has fallen almost 10% when it's adjusted and accounting for inflation. This has made it nearly impossible for the Social Security Administration to fulfill their core mission of serving beneficiaries. For example, the wait for a hearing is about 600 days. That is unacceptable, and American people deserve better. In addition, we are deeply concerned about the impact of some of the changes the Social Security Administration has been making without congressional approval. And again, I applaud the chairman here and members on both sides of the aisle with their concern about legislative oversight and review, as specifically as relates to regulations and administrative procedures. For example, I have strong concerns about Social Security reinstating the flawed reconsiderations appeal step in 10 states that are currently do not have it. Rather, Social Security should instead work with Congress to get disability decisions right the first time, so that the severely disabled workers who meet eligibility requirements can be approved without having to endure years of appeals. I also want to object, strong objections to the administration's recent executive order that is likely to politicize the appointment of the judges who hear disability appeals. Social Security Administration employs the vast majority of federal administrative law judges, who are ALJs, as they're called. Last year, they issued over 685,000 benefit eligibility decisions. It is my belief that the Americans who have contributed to the Social Security throughout their working lives deserve an impartial hearing before a highly qualified and independent judge rather than political appointees. Finally, I'd like to enter into the record a 2016 letter signed by then-ranking members of all the committees with jurisdiction over Social Security, objecting to a series of rules changes that were proposed and later adopted over the objection of the legislature. With that, I thank the chairman again and say what a great feeling it is to be here with you today in this new and renovated room, and the chairman is in an antique chair, as I learned that they found the other day in the bowels of the Capitol, dating back to the early 50s.
Thank you. As is customary, any member is welcome to submit a statement for the hearing record. And before we move on to our testimony, I want to remind our witnesses to please limit your oral statements to 5 minutes. However, without objection, all of the written testimony will be made a part of the hearing record. We have six witnesses today seated at the table are Patricia Jonas, the Deputy Commissioner, Office of Analytics, Review, and Oversight, Social Security Administration. They need some more words in there, I think. Elizabeth Curter, Director, Education, Workforce, and Income Security Issues, Government Accountability Office. Will Martin, Analyst in Income Security, Congressional Research Service. Jeff Price, Legislative Director, National Association of Disability Examiners. Lisa Ekman, Director of Government Affairs, National Organization of Social Security Claimants representatives on behalf of the Consortium for Citizens with Disabilities Social Security Task Force. That's a mouthful. The Honorable Ron Kass, President Kass and Associates PC. Thank you for being here, all of you. Ms. Jonas, welcome. Thanks for being here, and please proceed.
Chairman Johnson, Ranking Member Larson, and members of the subcommittee. I am Patricia Jonas, the Deputy Commissioner for the Office of Analytics, Review, and Oversight at the Social Security Administration. Thank you for inviting me to discuss our disability adjudication process. 35 years ago, I joined SSA as a hearing office attorney. Since then, I have served in various roles, including leading the administrative appeals judges who adjudicate cases at the final level of administrative review. Most recently, I agreed to lead the newly created Office of Analytics, Review, and Oversight, or ARRO. I dedicated my career to SSA because the link between our work and helping others is so clear. Social Security touches the lives of nearly every person in the nation, whether after the loss of a loved one, at the onset of disability, or at the transition from work to retirement. In fiscal year 2018, we expect to pay over $1 trillion in benefits to an average of over 70 million people. I certainly appreciate that how well we deliver our services matters. Today, I will provide an overview of our disability adjudication process, including the return to a uniform process in those states that have not had the second level of appeal since 1999, and our efforts to improve service at the hearing level. In order to frame our conversation, I'll briefly explain the steps in the disability process. When an individual requests a disability benefit, we send the case to a State Disability Determination Service, or DDS, which makes the initial disability determination. If an applicant is dissatisfied with an initial determination, there are up to three additional levels of administrative review: reconsideration, also handled by the state DDSs, a hearing before an administrative law judge, and review by our appeals council. In nine states and part of one state, we have been maintaining an artifact of a disability redesign prototype that eliminated the reconsideration step. Over the next 3 years, we will reinstate reconsideration to restore a uniform administrative review process that 75% of applicants already follow. Our disability process is large, and making disability decisions is complex. We are guided by the principle of determining whether someone is entitled to disability benefits as early in our administrative process as possible. Since 1999, we have continued to improve our process toward that goal. We converted from paper files to electronic files. We receive more and more electronic medical evidence, and we have developed case analysis tools that help ensure policy compliance. All of these enhancements now allow us to use data analytics to improve service at all our levels of our disability process. For instance, at the initial determination step, we implemented the compassionate allowance process, a review that quickly identifies and prioritizes 228 medical conditions that qualify for disability under our rules. At the reconsideration step, we use a predictive model to conduct targeted denial reviews to identify the most error-prone DDS denials that are likely to be allowances, preventing those cases from escalating to the hearing level. At the hearings level, we are expanding our use of software we call Insight, which helps us ensure policy compliance in our decisions, and we use data analytics to identify pending hearing requests that we should review again for possible allowance before a hearing is necessary. Our increasing use of data analytics and information technology will help us reduce our claimant's wait for a hearing decision. In addition, we appreciate the dedicated funding that Congress provided to us in fiscal years 2017 and 2018. We have reduced the number of people waiting for a hearing in each of the last 18 months, and we expect to end fiscal year 2018 with approximately 900,000 pending hearings. Based on our current efforts, which includes our plan to create a uniform adjudication process, we expect to reduce the average wait for a hearings decision to 270 days by the end of fiscal year 2021. Returning to a uniform national process is one more effort to identify possible allowances at the earliest point. And now is the optimal time because disability applications are at the lowest they have been in some time, and we will be current with our continuing disability reviews. It provides some claimants the opportunity to receive an allowance more quickly and will help alleviate the hearings backlog. I am proud to be a part of an agency that is dedicated to public service. Our employees understand what's at stake for our claimants, and we strive to thoughtfully evolve our policies and processes. I'm happy to answer any question you may have.
Thank you. Ms. Curta, welcome again. Please proceed.
Chairman Johnson, Ranking Member Larson, and members of the subcommittee, thank you for inviting me to discuss the Social Security Administration's efforts to manage its disability workloads. SSA has faced long-standing challenges processing disability workloads, most recently at the appeals level. At the end of fiscal year 2017, SSA reported that more than 1 million claimants were awaiting a decision on disability benefits at the appeals level, and they waited on average 605 days, nearly 20 months. We've issued several reports describing these challenges, SSA's efforts to reduce processing times, and its lack of a systematic evaluation to determine the impact of those efforts. We highlighted many of these issues in our testimony to this committee in March of this year. At that time, we noted the need for sustained focus on the part of SSA's leadership to approach these challenges strategically and follow through with rigorous plans to improve disability programs. Today, we build on this body of work with the release of a new report on SSA's efforts to manage its appeals workload by transferring cases from hearing offices with backlogs to offices with more capacity. My testimony will touch on two areas. One, SSA's challenges managing disability workloads at the appeals level. And two, the extent to which SSA has metrics to assess its efforts to reduce processing times. Regarding SSA's challenges with managing workloads, we found that both processing times at the appeals level and pending caseloads have increased in recent years. Specifically, from fiscal year 2012 to 2017, average processing time climbed by approximately 70%, peaking at 605 days in fiscal year 2017. Pending caseloads followed a similar pattern, growing to over 1.1 million cases in fiscal year 2016. However, in 2017, pending cases declined by 6% to just over 1 million. According to SSA officials and the OIG, several factors contributed to these trends, such as changes in hearings operations staff and regulations affecting judges' workloads. In the report we are releasing today, we examine one of SSA's efforts to reduce processing times at the appeals level by transferring appeal disability cases from offices with backlogs to those with more capacity. From fiscal years 2008 through 2017, the percentage of cases that were transferred increased from 14 to 43%. But despite the rising use of transfers, SSA cannot assess the effectiveness of these efforts due to a weakness in its average processing time metric. In particular, the current processing time metric attributes the entire processing time for a case to the office that finishes the case. Without an office-specific measure of timeliness for cases that are transferred, SSA cannot determine how individual offices contribute to processing times, information that is critical to assessing the effect of transferring cases on timeliness goals. We are recommending that SSA develop a timeliness metric or set of metrics that more accurately reflect offices' performance in light of case transfers. SSA agreed with this recommendation. Our past work and the OIGs have also highlighted the need for SSA to evaluate its efforts designed to reduce the backlog or improve program integrity at the appeals level. Our 2017 report on consistency in decision-making at the appeals level, for example, found that SSA had 5 different quality assurance reviews of hearings decisions, several of which have similar goals and look at similar claims, but SSA had not evaluated the efficiency or effectiveness of these reviews. We recommended that SSA evaluate these reviews, and it agreed. SSA has recently taken steps toward improving its evaluation that could enhance its ability to respond to our recommendations. Last October, it created a deputy commissioner-level office called the Office of Analytics Review and Oversight, CADLEADS, which is intended to foster data analysis of SSA's programs and enhance oversight of the disability adjudication system. However, the effects of these changes remain to be seen. In summary, we found that SSA has increasingly transferred cases between offices to help manage its appeals workloads. However, we also found that SSA does not have an accurate metric to assess how individual offices contribute to processing times, which could hinder the agency's ability to identify and address problems. We believe that by evaluating the effectiveness of this effort and others, SSA could better ensure that it's using its resources for maximum benefit toward improving the timeliness and quality of its disability decisions. This concludes my prepared statement, and I will be happy to address the committee's questions.
Thank you. Appreciate your testimony. Mr. Martin, welcome. Please go ahead.
Chairman Johnson, Ranking Member Larson, and members of the subcommittee, thank you for inviting me to testify on the Social Security Administration's plans changes to the disability appeals process. My name is Will Morton, and I'm an analyst in income security with the Congressional Research Service. Today, I will address the reconsideration level of the appeals process. These brief remarks summarize my written statement. SSA adjudicates two disability programs, Social Security Disability Insurance and Supplemental Security Income. Disability claimants who are dissatisfied with SSA's initial determination may request further review under the agency's administrative appeals process. This three-part process consists of reconsideration, a hearing before an administrative law judge, and a request for review by SSA's appeals counsel. Reconsideration is generally the first step of the process that a claimant must initiate in order to appeal an initial determination. Reconsideration involves a thorough review of the claim, a thorough review of all evidence from the initial determination, along with any additional evidence submitted as part of the appeal. It is effectively a new review of the claim by an adjudicator who did not participate in the original determination. Reconsideration was created in 1940 for Social Security retirement survivors claims and predates SSA's disability programs. It was envisioned as a relatively low-cost method for addressing the majority of contested issues on retirement survivors claims without the need for evidentiary hearings. Although it was not designed with disability in mind, reconsideration was extended to SSA's disability programs following their enactment. With respect to arguments for and against reconsideration, proponents contend that reconsideration prevents some, quote-unquote, unnecessary appeals from reaching the hearing level, resulting in lower administrative costs as well as a smaller hearings backlog. They also note that reconsideration results in some claimants being awarded sooner than they otherwise would be. On the other hand, opponents argue that reconsideration's relatively low allowance rate makes it a quote-unquote rubber stamp of SSA's initial determination. Opponents view reconsideration as an unnecessary impediment that adds several months to process for those claimants who go on to be approved at the hearing level. In October 1999, SSA initiated the prototype project in 10 states to test several modifications to the disability adjudication process, including the elimination of the reconsideration level. The goal of the prototype was to make various improvements to the initial level of the adjudication process that would afford the same benefits of reconsideration, but without the need for an additional level of review. These improvements included conferences between claimants and adjudicators at the initial level of the process. In January 2001, SSA issued a notice of proposed rulemaking to implement the prototype procedures nationally. However, several months later, SSA halted its implementation plan, citing higher than expected costs. In 2002, SSA discontinued claimant conferences at the initial level, citing increased processing times. Although the prototype was originally scheduled to conclude at the end of 2001, SSA has extended the project 13 times. The last such extension was issued in August 2016 and extends the prototype until the end of 2018. In February of this year, SSA informed Congress of its plan to reinstate reconsideration in the 10 prototype states over the next several years. SSA argues that reinstating reconsideration in these states will make its disability adjudication process more equitable nationally, as well as assist the agency in achieving its goal of eliminating the hearings backlog. Evaluating the effects of reinstating reconsideration in the prototype states is complex and challenging for two reasons. First, it's an inherently complex undertaking because it requires analyzing nearly a dozen different measures, such as appeal and allowance rates, administrative program costs, processing times, accuracy rates, and claimant satisfaction. Second, the data and analyses needed to evaluate the proposal are not readily available. SSA last released a detailed study of the prototype in 2001. The subsequent elimination of claimant conferences at the initial level, coupled with the passage of 17 years, has made SSA's 2001 analysis less informative about the prototype today. Without more recent data and analyses from SSA, it is difficult to provide a complete picture of the plan's likely effects. This concludes my brief remarks. Thank you for the opportunity to testify, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Price, welcome. Thanks for being here. Oops. Yeah.
Thank you, Chairman.
Please proceed.
Chairman Johnson, Ranking Member Larson, members of the subcommittee. My name is Jeff Price, and I'm the legislative director for the National Association of Disability Examiners with 39 years' experience in the disability program. And appreciates this opportunity to comment on examining changes in the Social Security disability appeals process. During FY 2017, SSA paid nearly $1 trillion in Social Security and SSI benefits to 70 million beneficiaries, including 18 million who were paid disability benefits. One in four workers currently age 20 will become disabled prior to attainment of their expected retirement age. Among that group, 67% will have no private disability insurance and will depend on SSA as the only source of income, making it imperative that the determination of who is eligible for these benefits be made accurately and timely. In 2017, DDS has processed 2.5 million initial claims and 600,000 reconsideration claims. DDS allowance rate was 33% at the initial level, 12% at the reconsideration level. DDS allowance decisions account for 77% of all allowances in FY 2017. Similar numbers are expected for FY 2018. The ability of the DDSs to adjudicate these cases timely and accurately carries enormous consequences for SSA and the citizens who rely upon the agency for assistance. Therefore, it is extremely critical the individuals tasked with this responsibility be highly trained and able to perform their job duties in a professional environment. If the claimant is dissatisfied with the initial termination, he or she has the right to appeal, the reconsideration being the first level appeal, which involves a thorough review of all evidence from the initial termination and any new evidence that is submitted at recon. In 1997, SSA introduced the prototype model for disability claims processing. 10 DDSs were selected for inclusion in this model that featured the elimination of reconsideration and the introduction of a single decision maker, or SDM. SDM was then expanded to 10 additional states in 1998. However, many pieces of the prototype model over the ensuing years were abandoned, leaving SDM and the elimination of reconsideration as the primary components in place. SDM remained in place until the Bipartisan Budget Act of 2015 mandated its elimination. The elimination of reconsideration in the 10 DDSs has continued to this day, with the effect that SSA has led a unified process with administration of the disability programs for more than 20 years. Recently, SSA announced its intent to reintroduce reconsideration into those 10 DDSs. Unfortunately, we've yet to see any major changes that will make reconsideration a more meaningful appeal step. More than 80,000 claims were allowed in FY 2017 at reconsideration, but we can do better. While NAID recommends disability decision makers should be made, it should be equal across the nation. We also believe that SSA should utilize the data collected over the past 20 years to determine if reconsideration is an effective model, and if so, what its future should look like. NAID members are divided in their support for and opposition against reconsideration. However, when asked if they would support a more enhanced reconsideration step, the vast majority have signaled their strong support. Currently, reconsideration remains mostly a second case review only scenario with limited claimant contact, and is widely perceived as producing a rubber stamp of the initial decision. They believe there is a future for enhanced reconsideration that will ensure the rights of those who seek assistance and that the determination or the definition of disability is not compromised. We believe there are viable options to enhance reconsideration, and we offer the expertise of our membership to determine how best to design this appeal step, or failing in that effort, how it should be eliminated. There are many challenges to ensuring disability decisions are made accurately and timely. There are challenges currently more important to DDSs and the lack of hiring authority to address critical staff shortages. Attrition rates in the DDSs have soared, leading to high caseloads that can contribute to increased processing times and diminished accuracy. It's in this environment that SSA has announced its decision to reintroduce reconsideration and to allocate much of its hiring authority to those DDSs. We believe the timing for this action is poor. DDSs lost over 1,600 employees in FY 2017, including over 1,200 adjudicators. FY 2018 will have similar numbers. It takes 2 to 3 years for a disability adjudicator to become proficient and make an accurate and timely disability decisions. It's imperative SSA recognize the need for DDSs to fill these vacant staff positions, and if necessary, delay its rollout or reconsideration until such time the agency has a more favorable budget. In summary, SSA's plans to introduce reconsideration will require significant investment resources. It comes at a time that DDSs face increased attrition, critical staffing shortages that have endangered their mission. When NAID supports the unified process, the equation of this is the most appropriate time
for SSA to reintroduce reconsideration. We also believe reconsideration should be a true first step. We stand ready, willing, and able to assist SSA and the interests of stakeholders in that endeavor. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Ekman. Welcome. Please proceed.
Good morning, Chairman Johnson, Ranking Member Larson, and members of the subcommittee. Thank you for the opportunity to testify at today's hearing. My name is Lisa Ekman, and I am the Director of Government Affairs for the National Organization of Social Security Claimants Representatives, or NOSCR. I'm here today on behalf of the co-chairs of the Social Security Task Force of the Consortium for Citizens with Disabilities, or CCD. The Social Security disability programs provide modest but vital benefits to millions of people with disabilities so severe they are unable to perform substantial work, many of whom would live in abject poverty and be homeless without them. The task force appreciates the efforts of the members of this subcommittee to provide SSA with funding dedicated to reducing the hearings backlog included within SSA's operating budgets for fiscal year 2017 and 2018. However, despite that funding, people are still waiting too long for a hearing decision, about 600 days. That has devastating consequences. Some people lose their homes, declare bankruptcy, and some even die. Recent changes to the disability adjudication process, purportedly designed to reduce the backlog, have instead created procedural barriers to accessing benefits and tilted the playing field toward denials for even people who meet the statutory definition of disability contained in the Social Security Act. SSA is in the process of making another highly controversial change to its disability process that will lead to greater delays and more inappropriate denials, reinstituting reconsideration in 10 states. The CCD Task Force has long supported the nationwide elimination of reconsideration. SSA generally takes no meaningful steps at this stage to ensure that additional evidence is obtained to help it reach the right decision. Making all claimants go through this level of review adds an average of 101 days to the wait time of the vast majority of claimants before they can request a hearing before an ALJ, which is the first time a disability claimant ever talks to or meets an adjudicator. Far more people will have to wait to receive their benefits than will get them earlier as a result of this proposed change. 7 out of 8 people are denied during reconsideration. Worse, thousands of claimants will not ever receive the benefits they are eligible for. Many who meet the statutory eligibility criteria will abandon their appeals because of this procedural hurdle. SSA is making this change without conducting a thorough and publicly available evaluation of its 20-year disability prototype experiment. The decision to reinstitute reconsideration is not based on data or evidence. Rather than reinstituting reconsideration, SSA should eliminate reconsideration and dedicate the resources it uses for reconsideration in the 40 states to improving the initial determination process with a particular focus on better development of the evidentiary record. The CCD Task Force recommends the following steps be taken to improve initial determinations. First, SSA should offer to have in-person meetings with as many claimants as possible, as soon as possible, to inform them about the process and what evidence is useful to SSA in making a determination. Previous pilots have found this simple step helps SSA arrive at the correct decision sooner, especially for unrepresented claimants. Second, SSA should improve the forms and guidance provided to treating physicians and consultative examiners to better explain what evidence is useful to SSA and elicit that evidence. Third, SSA should make claimants aware of the availability of representation at the initial level. Reinstituting reconsideration would add another procedural hurdle to the tilted playing field that other recent changes to the disability process have created. These are discussed more fully in my written testimony, but I will provide a few examples. First, SSA changes long-standing and court-approved rules regarding how it weighs evidence from a claimant's own physician. Instead of giving the highest weight possible to the opinion of a doctor who has treated the claimant for years, SSA adjudicators can now give greater weight to the opinion of an SSA consultant who performed a cursory exam or even a paper file review by a doctor who never even met or examined the claimant. A second example is requiring a claimant to submit all evidence that relates to his disability, even if that evidence is not relevant to the decision, creating huge files that increase processing time but not decisional accuracy. Finally, SSA created arbitrary deadlines for the submission of evidence that results in the exclusion of relevant evidence from consideration, leading to more appeals to federal court and the appeals council. To sum up, SSA has recently made regulatory changes that tilt the playing field against eligible claimants and create procedural hurdles to accessing benefits. Reinstituting reconsideration is a step in the wrong direction, harming significantly more people than it helps. When SSA tried previously to reinstate it, it had to withdraw its plan in the face of congressional opposition. I urge Congress to weigh in again. Thank you, and I look forward to answering any questions you might have.
Thank you, ma'am. Mr. Cass, welcome. Please proceed.
Thank you, Chairman Johnson, Ranking Member Larson, and members of the committee. I'm here today in my capacity of a longtime professor of administrative and constitutional law, meaning that they were afraid too many of you would still be awake at this point. The SSA appeals process, as you know, relies heavily on ALJs, and the Supreme Court, in its recent decision in Lucia against the SEC, ruled that the SEC's ALJs were not constitutionally appointed. That decision obviously has application to all ALJs, and it and follow-on actions such as the executive order of July 10th raise a number of questions. I'm going to make five brief points so that you can get to the dialogue between the committee members and the panel. First, Lucia itself is a fairly straightforward application of the Appointments Clause of the Constitution, Article 2, Section 2, Clause 2, and should not be a controversial decision. It follows directly from precedent as well as from the language and history of the Constitution. Second, implementing Lucia requires a number of agency-specific and program-specific policy choices. It does not require a number of very difficult legal choices. Third, the executive order doesn't answer most of the policy questions. It makes a fairly simple change in the appointment of ALJs, but leaves a great deal left for decision on a case-by-case or program-by-program basis. Fourth, the executive order, by placing ALJs in the accepted service rather than the competitive service, allows the constitutional hiring of ALJs, gives the opportunity to fix some issues that arose in the OPM, the Office of Personnel Management, administration of the program. I was the vice chairman of the International Trade Commission, which has ALJs doing patent trials, essentially. We had trouble getting ALJs with patent experience because the OPM program for hiring ALJs didn't allow that sort of tailoring. That can be fixed going forward. Fifth and finally, the questions addressing ALJs and their role in the disability hearing process are important questions. The way they should be organized, integrated within the agency, or separated from other members of the agency are important questions. But those questions should not be answered by a very simple analogy of ALJs to Article III judges. They're doing administrative adjudication within the executive branch, and the questions regarding how they should be treated and how they should be organized within that branch ought to be addressed on their own, not by simple analogy. I appreciate the opportunity to be here and look forward to answering any questions you may have.
Thank you for your testimony. We appreciate it. We'll now go to questions, and as is customary for each round of questions, I will limit my time to 5 minutes and will ask my colleagues to also limit their questioning time to 5 minutes as well. Mr. Morton, is it fair to say over the past 50 years that Social Security has tested out different changes to reconsideration, and what has Social Security learned from those tests?
Thank you, Chairman Johnson. Over the last 50 years, SSA has implemented a number of tests involving changes to the reconsideration level. Most of these tests have focused on adding pre-decisional interviews between claimants and adjudicators, whether at the reconsideration level or at the initial level, and replacing the and eliminating the reconsideration level. By and large, these have shown suggest that interviews earlier in the process increase claimant satisfaction with their overall experience. However, they do lead to generally higher administrative and program outlays. SSA, in its last detailed study, also noted that increased satisfaction does not necessarily have an effect on the appeal rates. So it's not increased satisfaction may not decrease someone's likelihood of appealing.
Thank you, sir. Ms. Jonas, this isn't the first time that Social Security has made plans to reinstate reconsideration nationwide. In fact, Social Security planned to do that almost 10 years ago, but then thought better of it. If it wasn't a good idea then, what's changed now?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think one of the things we would begin to think about is that the past efforts, both with disability process redesign and disability service improvement efforts, were both efforts to eliminate the reconsideration, but have additional efforts, additional processes that would enhance either the initial or the or the hearings level. So we were maintaining different processes over the years. You've asked what's different. So I think in 2010 we were talking about a significant number of initial new claims. In fact, the difference between initial receipts in 2011 versus today is about a million. So there are far fewer claims coming into the system. The actuary is estimating some reduction as well. So we have capacity at that level. Our CDRs are nearly current at this point. So the situation that we're looking at today looks different than it did the last time we were here. I think there's some other differences as well, and I think I alluded to them in my testimony about. So we have more and better data to be able to take advantage of some data analytics and some tools. I mentioned in my testimony the targeted denial reviews. So that really takes advantage of some advanced data analytics to be able to look at the most error-prone, identify the most error-prone cases that are happening at the reconsideration level and to, without the claimant asking for that review, go back and review that. So we've been doing that nationwide since 2012.
Well, okay. That's what I said, almost 10 years. And, you know, it's kind of a major decision. Why not wait for a Senate-confirmed commissioner to make the decision?
So, Mr. Chairman, I think this is the time, sort of an optimal time for us. I think we're looking, certainly concerned about, and have been having these conversations about the extended time period that people wait for a hearing. We have an opportunity in those 42 states. There are significant opportunities for claimants in those areas to have another look at their cases. And in fact, 75,000 individuals are allowed at that level without having to wait in line for a hearing. And in fact, about 21,200 people are sort of missing that opportunity in those 10 jurisdictions. So with the lower receipts and I think the capacity at the DDS level, and thinking about how we could take advantage of that, I think I'm concerned about again is that having this sort of disparate process sort of harms individuals who don't have that ability to submit that new information. So, give you a concrete example of the harm that can have. So, 60,000 individuals are denied at the initial level. They may have serious impairments. But the agency doesn't have the evidence to show that they meet what we call our duration requirement, that the condition is expected to last for 12 months. With reconsideration, they have the ability to submit additional evidence that updates the information, so those individuals don't have to wait in line for those 600 days to have a hearing, to add that new information and get a new decision. So I think we're looking at that opportunity to have, we think we have a meaningful process at this point in terms of being able to address those concerns about whether we're making the right decision at that level. But I think we also see that this is an opportune time to address that and also to make a significant impact on reducing the average wait time at the hearings level by dropping that back an additional year from 2022 to 2021, which would have a benefit across the board for all claimants.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. In my opening remarks, I didn't ask that the letter that I suggested be submitted for the record, if I could do that. And let me begin by saying, first of all, what a great panel. And I found the testimony incredibly informative. I'll say, Ms. Jonas, you must feel after listening to the testimony, that old George Global line, you ever feel like you're a pair of brown shoes at a black tuxedo event, because the testimony here is overwhelming, I think, with respect to reinstatement and the process here. And the chairman's advisement in terms minimally of waiting till there's actually someone appointed and encouraging the Senate to act on that, notwithstanding, let me go back and ask Ms. Ekman, to review the proposals that, rather than waiting on, that could be enacted.
Thank you, Ranking Member Larson, for the question. We believe that the CCD Task Force believes that the resources being used for reconsideration could much better be used to better develop the record at the initial level to get the decision right the first time. Often, as Deputy Commissioner Jonas mentioned, there is evidence that exists that the SSA does not have in front of it when it makes its decision. It should get that evidence before it makes a denial, because that is a waste of everybody's time and SSA's resources. It is not that the DDS doesn't want to do this. It's, as Mr. Price said, it is because the DDSs don't have the resources to do that. They follow their regulatory requirements in terms of trying to get evidence, but I don't know if you've ever tried to collect your own medical evidence, but it can take months, repeated attempts, and the DDSs just don't have the resources right now to do that. If the resources used for reconsideration were reprioritized to get that evidence, have a complete file in front of those DDS examiners, everybody could get their decision sooner, and it would be a much better use of the resources for everyone. And instead of making 7 out of 8 claimants wait longer to ask for a hearing, everyone could get those decisions sooner. And there are other things they can do, like the claimant interviews, although the SSA has previously found them to be expensive. Administratively, I'm not sure they were comparing that to the cost of a hearing. I am not sure they were comparing that to the cost of going through the whole process. Yes, it costs extra money up front, but it saves a lot of money on the back end and gets claimants their decision sooner, which benefits everybody, the claimants, SSA, and the public.
Ms. Jonas, I'm going to ask you about the what I think is common sense validity of what Sekman has laid out there, but I also would want you to respond. I know that you said in your remarks that, how 21,000 people would be benefit, but about 106,000 disabled workers will have to wait longer for a hearing, and almost half of them will ultimately be found eligible by an ALJ. That's 50,000 people. but under your plan, as you propose, as I see it, these 50,000 people will have to wait even longer than they do now in order for the 21,000 people to get their benefits earlier. Moreover, an estimated 7,500 people will lose their benefits entirely. My question is, does that seem fair? And what about Ms. Ekman's proposal?
So, Mr. Larson, I think one of the things that is fundamental to this whole conversation across the panel here is about the importance of medical evidence, and that medical evidence in an individual's condition typically doesn't remain static. And what we've seen in our studies is that one of the reasons why individuals might be denied at a lower level but allowed later is because they've aged, they've grown into an older age category, which has vocational significance to that.
You could die in the time that you have to wait to get a disability hearing here, and it seems to me that we ought to be able to adjudicate this earlier. And notwithstanding, I think, the need to increase funding, but just money isn't the problem. There seems to me to be having to look at this for the long period of time. I don't disagree with the chairman that we ought to make sure that we have someone who's heading up Social Security. But this ought to be a focus. The people at this table could come up with a solution, I think, in about a day. that could benefit and help streamline this process to what I think is everybody's objective, to make sure that people who deserve the disability get it in a timely fashion.
Sir, and I think we're all in the same place about wanting the most efficient and effective process, something that works for all of this process.
That can't possibly be fair under this ruling that you have to wait 600 days. And, you know, as the chairman says, you've been looking at this system, and just to arbitrarily reinstitute it in the face of all this evidence just seems to me to be a wrong-headed policy.
So our policy, we have good policy compliance in looking at these cases. And again, I'll just sort of reinforce, I think this is a meaningful evaluation and assist people with this process. And it seems, I think one of the issues that my colleagues here are raising is, you know, there is a cost to this program, and I'm trying to be efficient and effective, and nobody wants 600 days either. And I think with this process, what we're suggesting is reinstituting reconsideration. Part of that will benefit individuals in advancing this ability to get to the, reduce the backlog by 2021.
My time is up. You didn't answer the question with regard to the segments proposals and why they wouldn't have any greater impact than the reinstatement process.
Thank you for your question. I think that's good advice. Mr. Rice, you're right.
You're seeing claims, initial claims decline, correct?
Correct.
These figures here looks like you had 1,122,000 in 2016, and in fiscal year 2017, 1,056,070,000 down, and you're projecting 900,000 for 2018.
Correct, and we're expecting some, you know, actuaries suggesting some additional decline.
Lower than 900,000?
I wouldn't speak for the actuary. We can certainly provide his information.
I guess the economy's working out, people going back to work. Let me ask you this. Why, then, are you not seeing similar declines in wait times?
So as that process works through, so those individuals in the wait times that we're addressing here, so as those cases are working their way through the process, the pendings will be dropping, but it'll take some time for the wait times to follow. So we would anticipate, for example, at the hearings level, where we're talking about 600 days under this plan, we would expect some diminishing in the number of the claims, but probably the wait time the next fiscal year to be about 500 days, but by the end of 2021, it would be at 270.
Claims declined by 70,000 from 2016 to 2017. Your wait time went up by 10% from 550 to 600 days.
So, again, we're looking at, in some cases, this is the oldest cases that are calculated into this, trying to reduce those. We did have issues back in the last fiscal year with regard to having to move some work around or not being able to get to it because of the hurricanes, but not significantly.
Yeah, this is our huge problem in my state. Columbia has about 6,000 cases backlog, but Charleston has 10,000. Do you know if they're moving cases between Columbia and Charleston?
I'm not familiar with that specific.
I also read in here, quote, the SSA has not developed adequate metrics to determine how or if case transfers affect timeliness. That just doesn't seem that it would be that complicated.
The hearing offices are utilizing a case processing system that doesn't take advantage of the ability to identify that. This is an older case processing system and part of
the... Designed in the 50s or something like that?
Designed probably over 10 years ago, which was not anticipating the kind of workload transfers that we're talking about today.
Gosh, it just seems so basic. I'm looking at these approval levels here, and I don't know how much to where that I got you. It says that 33% of cases are allowed at the initial level.
Correct.
And then 13% at the
reconsideration
level. Now, is that 13% of the remaining cases or
13% of the cases that are heard at the reconsideration level. About 75% of all the claims that are allowed by the agency are allowed at the DDS level initially in reconsideration.
DDS?
The Disability Determination Services.
Okay. And then 26% are allowed at the hearing level.
Sorry, I think that's 46%.
Oh, 46%.
I'm sorry, that was their allowance rate. I think you're correct in terms of the number.
Okay, so overall, what percentage of claims that are initially filed are ultimately accepted?
So I think we'll have to get back to you on the record.
Okay. Seems pretty basic. Mr. Cass, Professor Cass, you said that this SEC hearing or decision by the Supreme Court could yield benefits in terms of helping to streamline Social Security and in fact, lower this backlog. How would that work? Your microphone.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
When you have a change in the appointment of ALJs, you can have the appointment process take place more quickly. You can have people hired whose ability to focus on what it is that you want them to do is greater, and you can integrate them, if you choose, into your system so that you have a more seamless way of communicating what needs to be done with them. Now, I'm not a specialist in Social Security, so I don't know.
Are you saying in a nice way that we can get more qualified people? Is that what you're saying?
Well, I'm saying that you can get people whose qualifications fit more exactly each agency's needs.
Thank you, sir. My time's up.
Thank you. I appreciate those questions, Mr. Pascrell. You're right.
Thank you. Ms. Jonas. Does the Social Security Administration have plans to fix the first step in the appeals process so that we reduce the need for severely disabled workers to have to wait for a hearing before a judge to assess the benefits that they have earned? And if so, tell us about it.
So what our plan does not call for any significant changes in the initial claim process. Again, I think we're looking here in terms of advancing the issues with regard to the reconsideration. However, as you know, part of the Office of Analytics, one of the things we're looking at is this issue that I think I kind of alluded to earlier about what happens between time passes for individuals and claimants and what makes the difference. We may have policy compliant decision that was made initially, but then later another policy compliant decision could be made with a different outcome. So again, things have claimants' conditions worsen, new evidence is provided, and claimants age into these categories. So although I think we have good, what we consider is good policy compliance at each of our steps, we do recognize that this is fundamentally an individual who comes to the Social Security Administration may not have the same condition on day one as they will 600 days later. And that we don't want anyone to wait for 600 days. We want to be able to make the right decision as early in the process as possible. So when we establish the disability process redesign efforts and the disability service improvement efforts, we had really three goals in mind. And I think they're still the same three goals. And the first one was for individuals who would be eligible, pay them as soon as we can in the process. The second one, when you start looking at this question, is also, so reduce the wait times. And I think that the challenge that we have here with the prototype process here and the elimination of reconsideration, it has not reduced those wait times. It has harmed individuals who have to sit and wait for that 600 days. And the third element that we were looking for across the board is to make the process more efficient. And I think that reflects, I think, again, whether it was disability process redesign, the disability service improvement, or any effort, I think those remain our three goals.
What do you mean by making the system more efficient? That sounds good. What do you mean?
So I think it means if we've got 2.5 million people coming to the table, we've got to have a process that works for everybody, works for people in terms of an efficient process.
Do you think this process is working efficiently for everybody?
I don't think that, and especially with regard to this process where some individuals have the opportunity to submit information, but some don't and have to get in that line, that seems inefficient, that seems unfair.
I had some questions about medical evidence, but let me go on to this. I want to echo here what I've heard from the panel, from members on this side. New Jersey's not one of the 10 states that will now require disability applicants to go through another appeal step. My constituents are already forced into the failed reconsideration process. The Social Security Administration should fix the first appeals step rather than reinstating this flawed process in other states. Period. And if you don't do that, you're working against yourself. We know the problems. But for those who do not know, you should be aware that most of the people impacted by reinstating reconsideration, or the courts doing that, whatever. I think this is the first time the Social Security could ever make such a dramatic change without the Congress. Can you recall another time?
So specifically, I think we've issued a number of regulations which are under authority to issue those.
That experienced longer delays for getting their benefits, and some are expected to face a total loss of benefits. I mean, that's bizarre. Unacceptable. I'm sure it's unacceptable to you. About 106,000 severely disabled workers will have to wait longer for a hearing. And almost half of them will ultimately be found eligible by an administrative law judge. That means disabled workers are going to wait longer to receive the benefits they earned, and some will lose benefits, approximately 21,000 individuals could have gotten benefits sooner. Does it make sense, the decision? Does it make sense to me? And to you heard from the rest of the folks there, and you will hear for more. This administration must reverse course on this foolish idea now. Let me add that the problem will be compounded by the new executive order that will politicize administrative law judges. We don't even have time to discuss that today. Appointing these judges based on their politics, as opposed to the long-standing merit-based procedures, is wrong. Read the executive order. This process was designed to protect impartiality. Adding the whims of being partisan, ideological, gives me great trepidation. More judges can reduce average wait times, are already exceeding 600 days. But how much longer will people have to wait when politics is interjected into the process? And that's where we're going. We saw the budget of 2019. On page 32 of the budget, if you look, we're talking about a $64 billion cut in SSIs. So how are we going to do what is being recommended here? Forget about what I'm saying. What I already heard. How are you going to do that when you're going down that slippery slope to efficiency? Where are we going to wind up here? So,
why did they have the time to
expire? I will yield back now, Mr. Chairman. You've been very generous with your time. But we have a big, big problem and a mess. And you've seen it. You've worked on it. And the response has not been very good. But we're behind you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Bishop. You're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for raising the issue. Thanks to the panel for being here today to discuss the issue. It's obviously something that's important to all of us. We all are engaged in constituent services every day, and this is an issue that is raised frequently by folks who contact our office and every one of our offices. So finding ways to make it more efficient is a priority, and we want to do whatever we can to assist. I wanted to reiterate the concern that's been raised about the
decision to reinstate the reconsideration stage of disability appeals process on a nationwide basis. Since 1999, Michigan is one of those 10 prototype states. So we have really appreciated that change. And the effect of the program has been that the last 20 years, disability applicants in my home state have experienced shorter wait times. In fact, on average, it saved us about 100 days. So that's a big deal, especially when we consider that it's the average wait time in this huge backlog is 600 days. That's 2 years. It's just unacceptable. And I know that you've heard that from all of us. So we're looking for ways to address that. In my Lansing hearing office in Lansing, Michigan, the average processing time is currently 575 days. That's less than the national average. But reinstatement of reconsideration could change that entirely. And so we're very concerned about it. So, Ms. Jones, I know that you're kind of in the focal point of this discussion today, and rightfully so. I understand that I want to raise the issue, and the others on the panel have raised the issue too. Only 10% of claimants who eventually receive benefits are granted benefits at the reconsideration level. That's great for that 10%. But while those 10% may get a decision faster, we know that the almost 50% who aren't allowed benefits until the final hearing are really in a very bad position, having waited a long time for that process. I'm trying to understand. This is a significant decision on the part of your office. Who makes that decision? Is there an individual that makes the decision?
This is an agency-led decision. I want to just briefly address something, though. I think that to put in context with this, in terms of, again, I think where we all agree that 600 days processing time or wait time is not acceptable. Part of the goal with having this uniform process put in place for all of the states, again, I think would benefit an initial 21,000 individuals along the way, would also play a significant role in reducing that time period in which we can get to a 270-day wait time from the end of FY 2022 to 21. So I think it benefits all claimants across the board.
Well, that's not the case when it comes to Michigan. By the way it looks in the national average, and it appears as though it's going to hit Michigan and the claimants in Michigan very hard, and I'm sure that's true for a number of our other members who are part of these prototype states. But I'm just interested, I asked the specific question, who makes the decision? You said it was an agency-level decision. What does that mean? What's an agency-level decision?
So that's a commissioner-led decision.
Commissioner. So is there a person that made the decision, or is it a commission that makes that decision? Because I'm wondering, the question is, we're on the precipice of having some place there appointed to that position, and I just wondered, would it make more sense, and I know this question's been asked, but I want to reiterate it, would it make more sense of something this significant to wait for that person?
So again, I think as we came to the table here, I think part of this conversation was, you know, what's different between then and now, and is it sort of an opportune time to take advantage of this. I think where we're at this point is, again, that opportunity where we've got capacity in our DDS is to handle this because of the reduced receipts. It would reduce the number of cases going into the hearings backlog, which would assist us in reducing that average wait time sooner. So I think we saw this as the timing was appropriate.
Okay. Boy, there's a number of different questions to ask here. I wish that I had more time, and we have limited time here, and I know there are other folks that are wishing to ask questions. Okay, well, I will then. Ms. Ekman, I'd like to ask you a question. Social Security spent $122 million last year to administrative services, such as fee withholding and travel expenses for hired claimant representatives. Or the agency only received $30 million in reimbursement for those services. So, in the end, that's $92 million lost to Social Security's trust funds. The Office of Management and Budget has proposed that Social Security stop providing the services to save money. It seems like that's a significant amount of money. It doesn't seem like it is. like to know your opinion. And do you think that funds could be put to better use?
Thank you for that question, Representative Bishop. I think, first of all, I just want to make sure it's clear that the money that is paid to representatives doesn't come out of the trust fund separately. It comes out of past due benefits for the individual. So that is not costing the trust fund any money. It is because the claimant decided they needed a representative, so they hired them, and they agreed to pay them part of the past due benefits. I think that the direct withholding of fees is vital. Yes.
That's the question. But paying it back, where is it paid back to?
It comes out of the past due benefits. It goes to the representatives. So it is coming out of the claimant's past due benefits, not generally out of the trust fund. Those benefits would go to the claimant, to the person who is awarded benefits, if it didn't go to the representative. But I think what's really important to keep in mind is those figures you state do not account for the amount of money SSA saves by the function that representatives play. If you look at recent SSA Office of Inspector General reports as well as GAO reports, the representatives play very important functions for both claimants and the agency. They help get evidence. They decrease the number of hearings that are postponed significantly. And they also increase the development of the file. So I think that if you were to eliminate the direct withholding of fees and the payment of those fees to representatives, many Social Security disability claimants would no longer be able to get representation. We know this is the case because they couldn't before the direct withholding of fees was SSA was forced to do that by Congress. And no one is well served by increasing the number of unrepresented claimants. SSA benefits, as I said, from the development of the record and more hearings being held on time and not rescheduled, which is very costly for the agency. Enacting this proposal would be expensive because it would actually cost the agency more than $300 million over 10 years based on the OMB proposal score. It would be inefficient and it would be bad for claimants. So we urge Congress not to move forward with any change to the direct withholding of fees for representatives.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Lewin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for having this hearing today. I also want to thank the witnesses for your testimony and for being here today. Ms. Curta, I wanted to ask you a question. The GAO report released today looks at whether or not shifting cases to other offices really help with the case timelines. And the wait time, for instance, in the Chicago National Hearing Center is the second highest in the nation at 825 days, which is simply unacceptable. And so in looking at the report, what were your findings on this strategy of shifting cases to other offices? And can you elaborate on what the SSA would need to measure this strategy of shifting cases effectively?
Certainly. Thanks for that question. In the past, a case would come into a field office, and it would be processed more or less entirely by that office. More recently, SSA has gone to transferring cases between offices to take advantage of capacity that might exist elsewhere in the system. So you have one office that's backlogged, you have another office that has capacity. I think it makes sense to take advantage of all the capacity in a system to process a case. However, the timeliness measure has not kept pace with this change in operations, and we now have something like 40% of cases being handled by more than one office. So the timeliness metric is being calculated based on the last office that processed the case. So all of the time that was spent on the case is attributed to that office, whether or not they handled all of the processing. So you still don't have the information about other offices that handled the case and may have added to the time or and so forth. So what we'd like to see is, what we recommend it, is that SSA reevaluate its measure of timeliness in light of its case transfer process and come up with a measure that more accurately reflects the contributions of each office to the processing of the case. Without that, SSA cannot assess whether transfers are having their intended effects. and they can't hold individual hearing offices accountable for the time that they've spent on the case.
And what's your confidence level on the implementation of that and it being successful?
They agreed with our recommendation. I believe they have the information they would need to do this kind of a measure. And so I am hopeful that it will be implemented.
And what's the timeline on when we should know whether it's properly being implemented in an effective and efficient and accountable way?
Well, we track the implementation of our recommendations very closely, and we are in regular communication with the Social Security Administration. We are now meeting on a quarterly basis to talk about outstanding recommendations, and we update them at a minimum every year. But we will be on tracking the implementation of this and in touch with SSA about their progress.
Well, we would look forward to staying in touch with you on a quarterly basis to find out how this is tracking and making sure that those metrics are being fulfilled and that are meeting are in compliance, I guess, moving forward. So we look forward to working with you on that. Thanks. Mr. Cass, I wanted to switch. I know Mr. Rice had asked you about the recent Supreme Court decision, and I know there was a recent executive order on ALJ hiring also. Can you talk a little bit about the Supreme Court decision and that executive order and whether they'll have a negative impact on claimants' due process or the fairness of the ALJ proceedings going forward?
Certainly. The Supreme Court decision simply says that under the Constitution, an ALJ is an inferior officer. It is not somebody who's an employee, somebody who has enough responsibility to have to be appointed under the Appointments Clause, which means the agency head has to do the appointment. It's a simple change, but it is one that is consistent with the Constitution. It doesn't have to have any impact. Certainly, it doesn't have to have any negative impact on the fairness or the efficiency of the proceeding. The same is true of the executive order. The executive order says that ALJs are hired through the accepted service. You can tailor the requirements to the needs of each agency and each ALJ being hired. That's all the executive order does. The executive order doesn't say these will be political appointees, they'll be appointed in a way that will reduce the fairness of the process in any way. All of the matters that have to do with the fairness and the efficiency of the process are not reduced or impaired by either the Supreme Court decision or the executive order.
Thank you for that. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Social Security needs a consistent nationwide appeals process and one that provides for fair, accurate, timely decisions. Reinstating reconsideration is a big decision and one that should only be made by a Senate-confirmed commissioner. I once again call on my Senate colleagues to act quickly to confirm the next commissioner. You think the Senate hears me? We need strong leadership, Social Security now. Americans won't need and deserve nothing less. Thank you to all our witnesses for your testimonies and to our members for your questions. Thank you also for being here. With that, the subcommittee stands adjourned.
Mr. Chairman, I just wanted to thank you. This has been one of the most instructive hearings that we've had, and I especially appreciate it exerting both what the House needs to do with regard to our senators and also the legislative priorities of the House of Representatives, which you've heard from all of our members that aren't being, that don't get heard, and just demonstrates again why we need a process like this, and I commend you for it.
Thank you all for being here.
Thank you.